In the following, I want to briefly discuss a few additional topics in database systems. First of all, different layouts for the data storage and disk, then different workload assumptions, and finally, some brief overview on in-memory databases. In the beginning of the course, we looked at how the database system is storing tuples in pages on disk. And what we assumed there is that you're storing inside a page, inside a file, these individual tuples, one after the other. Now this can look like this. Here we have a table with professional information and the corresponding file content on disk. And you see that we are storing tuple after tuple inside a file. That means we're storing the entire tuples one after the other. Since tuples corresponds to row, this is also called row after row layout, or short row store. So when you're accessing a block on disk within a row store, you have access to all of the attributes of all tuples in that block. So if you're reading a tuple, a row, you have the employee ID, you have the name, the salary, and the position. Now consider you have the following queries. Query 1 wants to change the salary of professor with ID 2136 to 85,000. Now you go to the block corresponding to this entry, you read the block, and then you have access to the entire information. So you can see that the ID is indeed 2136, and then you can update the salary information here within that tuple. If you have a query that asks for the salary of Professor Socrates, well, you're retrieving the block where Socrates' tuple is contained. You can do this, in this case, by the name Socrates. And then when you find the Socrates tuple, you also know already the salary because it's contained in the tuple. Now the third query would ask for the average salary of a professor. What do we have to do? Well, we have to go through the entire file and look for the salary informations. Like this. So we don't care about the other information, only for the salaries. And you see also that you have to read, of course, the entire file. Also, you're interested only in this salary information, but you have to read also the other rest of the file. This file can be really big in some applications, and you need only a few information out of this, namely, in this case, the salary, to compute the average salary. So, well, you have to read quite a lot, right? Only to get the salary. And if you have a query like, what is the average salary of a C4 professor? Yeah, well, then you also have to go through that. But now anyway, you would need also the information about the position of the professor. So it would not be enough to have only a file with the salaries. What about the query that asks for how many professors are there in total? You don't need to read over the entire file in principle because you don't really care about the all information stored. If you had one file where only the employee IDs are stored, you can just read that file and see how many IDs you have instead of reading the entire file. So these are different types of queries, and depending on the type of query and the frequency of these kind of queries coming, one or the other solution of the data layout decisions is better than the other. Let's do a simple so-called back of the envelope calculation in the following, that is looking at one table called creditworthiness. And we have 5 million entries here. And in this table, we see for different people identified by the social security number, what is the risk indicator in order to assess if it's risky to give them a new credit. And you have here some, also some debt information and so on. Now this file, let's assume, has 5 million entries, and every entry, so every tuple, consumes 500 bytes, making some assumptions about the bytes for the individual attributes. Now, if our disk reads 100 megabytes per second, then reading the file requires 25 seconds. Now, if we have a query, select average depths from this table, we have to read the entire file, which takes 25 seconds. The entire file is a 2.5 gigabyte file. But in fact, we would not need all of the information because what we need is only the depth information here of the individual entries. So what if we had one file where we only store this information here? Well, then this file would be only 20 megabyte large. Why? Well, 5 million entries and 4 bytes for the int information in our depth attribute. So reading these 20 megabyte only would take 0.2 seconds reading from disk. Now compare the 0.2 seconds to the 25 seconds reading the entire file. So if you have a query like this, perhaps we do not want to store row after row, but we want to split these attributes in different files, because then these files individually are much shorter. In database research, there are usually two different names considered for the workload assumptions, so for the kind of workloads we have. The first one is called OLDP, and the second one is called OLAP. OLDP stands for Online Transaction Processing. Here we consider a database system in normal operation, like for instance some flight booking or processing orders in an online store. We have insert, update, delete operations, so these queries are very simple. So they're adding information or changing information, deleting information, but they're usually regarding only like a tuple or very few tuples that they are changing. In contrast to this, in OLAP, online analytical processing, we have the situation where we have more complicated queries that are doing data analysis, for instance, decision support. So these queries usually involve data aggregation, like group by and aggregation statements. So they are more expensive. And depending on the kind of workload, different realizations of database systems have advantages or disadvantages. In contrast to the row store, the idea in the column store is to store individual attributes, so the columns of a table, inside different files. So in this case of our table with professor information, we have four files. Here we have one file storing the employee ID. Here we have one file storing the names, the salary, and here we have the position. And now if we have one query asking for the average salary of all professors, we only have to read this file. And that's of course very efficient, because this one file is much shorter than reading the entire table, as we would have to do in a row store. Now, of course, we also have to be able to reconstruct the initial table, because we have to not only read these salaries, but we also want to know perhaps what is the salary of Socrates. So we have to somehow find the salary and corresponding to Socrates. And perhaps we want to have the entire tuple describing Socrates, so we have to make somehow these four attributes to find each other. And how can we reconstruct that? Well, this depends on the way the data is stored in the files for the individual columns. In one case, we talk about correlated columns when the order in these columns is the same, so corresponding to the initial table. And we see here indicated by this object ID, they are the same in all of these files. In this case, we can avoid storing such additional information, and the data can be stored just like this, because we know that the first tuple, or the first tuple from this file, which is like this attribute only, connects to this one, or belongs to this one, belongs to this one, and to this one. And then likewise for the others as well, we can reconstruct, right? If this is not given, so we have uncorrelated columns, we need additional information. Here we have to define some key, OID called in this case, which is used to join these individual columns into larger tuples. In the end, we can also reconstruct, of course, the entire table if you want. How do we reconstruct? Well, we do natural joins, right? So if you want to reconstruct the employee ID and the name, we have to join these two files based, of course, on OID. And if you want to find also the other information, well, we take what we just did and join with this column 2 and later on with column 3. So we have here three join operators involved, and you can imagine that this is of course coming with additional work. And in case we have a query saying select everything from our table, we need to perform these join operations. And well, it's probably easy to see that if we had already this table in a row store instead of the column store partitioning, then we would save computing and IO. So in the case you have such queries, then the row store is preferred over the column store. However, if you have only a query asking for the average salary, then you have a big advantage here using a column store. So the observation that the number of attributes you want to retrieve from your initial table in the column layout influences the time it takes to reconstruct was already made in a paper from 1985 that was called a decompositional storage model. Now, what the authors there proposed was exactly this decompositional storage model, which is a column store in our understanding now. And what you see here in this illustration is on the y-axis, the gains, or the gain ratio in terms of the number of blocks required to read in a row store divided by the number of blocks you have to read in a column store. And here you see, for instance, that if you have only one attribute you want to retrieve, then these gains are immense. We have a factor of 7 improvement of the column store over the row store. And if you're going further and you want to retrieve more attributes in your select statement, then you have to pay the price, and this gain goes down until the decompositional storage model, so the row store, is more costly than the row store itself. On the x-axis, you see here simply the number of records going from very small to quite large. Talking about these tuple reconstructions, there's an interesting concept called early or late materialization. What this means is if you are doing an early materialization, so you have a query accessing certain relations and certain columns of these relations, then in early materialization you would read from this the different columns and you would join them to reconstruct the tuples, and then you would process these tuples like in a traditional row store. However, this can be wasteful to reconstruct the full tuples. Hence, in the late materialization, what is proposed is to postpone the tuple reconstruction to a later point in time. Particularly for selection or aggregation, this can have big gains over the naive early materialization. In general, we do not have to create individual files for the individual attributes of a table, but we can be more flexible here, and this is what is described in the term vertical partitioning. So if you have a relation with n attributes, then there are not only n ways to partition like we would do in the simple column store, but you can think about having multiple different partitions of these n attributes, and every partition would correspond to one file that you're storing on disk. So in the column store, as I said, you partition column wise. So you have, in the end, n files, n tables, one for each attribute inside our relation R. In general, if you're not constrained to the individual columns, but you can have all kinds of partitions, even allowing redundancy, the number of possible partitions is given by the so-called bell number. And if you have a table with 5 attributes, you see you have already 52 possibilities to partition the schema, so the attributes, these 5 attributes, into individual smaller tables, into individual files. In contrast to the column store, which is like this one end of the spectrum, we have, of course, the row store, where we have only one partition. So one table which contains all the attributes of our initial table. And here's an example of vertical partitioning. We have one table here, which stores the employee ID and the name. Here we have one table storing only the position of the professor. And here we have one table storing the name and the salary. And now it's pretty simple to see. And also we talked about this a little bit already when we talked about schema denormalization some weeks ago. You can think now for which queries these individual partitions would be particularly useful. And it's of course not, as I said, not difficult to see that if you're asking often what is the salary of a certain professor, where the professor is given as the name of the professor, then of course this schema will be very good, because here you have one file that stores the data that you need to answer this query. If you want to have all information, then you have to again do a join. So you have to take this table here, join with this one, and then finally, to also include the salary, you have to also join with the last one. And in addition, not only causes this a bit trouble when you need all of this information, but of course this partitioning also has pros and cons when you're looking at insert, update, and delete operations. Because if you have redundancy here, then for instance, if you say we want to change the name of Socrates, then you have to change it here first of all and here first of all. Right? However, there can also be some benefits if you have some decomposition, because also for updates you could have gains in performance if you're reading smaller files on disk and not the entire table. In literature, we have two terms which are corresponding to row store and column store. Here we say we have NSM, which is called N-Array Storage Model for row store, and DSM is the aforementioned, in this paper title, proposed decompositional storage model. And this corresponds to column stores, or in general, what we had seen earlier, vertical partitioning, where it does not have to be individual attributes in the individual files.